So this is take two, take three. So I'm shooting I can make a video of a commentary about the movie Civil War. I recently was able to see the movie Civil War with my documentary maker, Brian Den Hartog. So it was very interesting. He invited me to see Civil War, and I was already planning to see it because I can see it very cheaply here in Amsterdam. But this is worth it. It's a movie I might see again at some point very near the future, next week or the week after. So, like always, when I make a video review or any analysis, I meander. I am not a good editor. I don't edit content. I hate editing. I hate the technical side of that. So my strength will probably lie in meandering through the impressions I got from the movie Civil War. The movie maker does something which I recognize from my own experiences in world building. You create impressions and you leave a whole bunch of things sort of suggestive in the background so that the viewer, the human viewer, starts amassing these images and filling in the blanks with his imagination, with his subconscious, with his personal viewpoints, with his personal subjective side of this. And that's super powerful way of making movies. I'm going to contrast this with Dune and with some other science fiction movies, the hard science fiction movies, realistic hard science fiction movies. So I would say Civil War is a very good movie. I really liked what Alice Garden did in that movie. I encourage everyone to go see it. Many people will see it, of course, on Netflix or whatever kind of streaming service. But the movie experience for me is sort of like an essential, authentic experience for a good movie. I grew up as a kid watching cinema, and there wasn't anything like streaming. I literally rewatched my first movies that I really wanted to rewatch on VHS cassette. So yeah, that is so paleo. It's a good movie. It drives home a succession of impressions and conclusions that is awesome. That's just highly recommended. To gorge it as open-minded as possible. Now, about world building. It's a silly hobby, but I like world building. So I take a bunch of premises that immediately arouse an emotion in me, and then I fill in the blanks. A few times based on dreams, but often based on necessity. I did a bunch of role-playing stuff. So when you make a role-playing game, tell a story, you create a world and you fill in the blanks and to make it as credible as possible. And I've been quite successful a few times. And to the point is that when I see a movie, I did a bunch of cyberpunk role-playing games. So I did a bunch of cyberpunk world building. And a good example of this is I did a New York-based one where I created the Venice of New York, which is based in Jamaica Beach. That's a region of New York and Long Island. It's swamp. It's actually quite not one of the best neighborhoods. It's very impoverished, low quality housing, etc. And a lot of immigrant stuff happening there. And Jamaica Beach itself is a huge sprawling area. And in my storyline, set in 2048, which is ironic, I placed rushing ships there. This story I told somewhere around, I think, late 90s, to people that were becoming increasingly disinterested in my stuff, because I was very gothic at the time. That creates a sort of negative mindset. And I put in the Jamaica area of New York, I put in these rusting ships, so there was a shipbreaking area like what you see in Western India. And it's a court, of course, a very solid like cyberpunk imagery. And you see similar things happening in the game Cyberpunk 2077, which I, of course, introduced. It was a lot of my stuff was based on Shadowrun, Cyberpunk, Cyberspace, GURPS, and other similar games. I took, like, I collected everything and mashed it into a coherent part. And I couldn't convey this to my players. It was so esoteric. And they were not into Cyberpunk. They were sort of into what I did as a storyteller, bringing people together, because there wasn't much alternative in the world that was particularly interesting and easy to access. And a lot of my players were very loyal to my stuff. A few. But I found those elements, to my bewilderment, in Blade Runner 2049, which is 1 year removed from this. In my story, I made a dike keeping out rising sea waters, which was obvious in the 1980s that it was going to happen within a century. Fasty rising sea waters was obvious. And the dike I described in a particular way, which is also completely visible in 2049, Blade Runner 2049. Of course, this movie was riddled with the memetics from the old Blade Runner that echoed, and that story extended in the future. And you end up with Blade Runner 2049 and the same process of world building and creation I enjoyed in my storylines, in my cyberpunk storylines. It is a shame that I wasn't able to do more of this, because I think I'm pretty good at it. And in June, especially Part 2, in Blade Runner, in other movies of Denis Villeneuve, and Neil Blomkamp is very good at it. Elysium is nice, but District 9 is maybe even nicer in that regard. You create impressions. World building is a lot of stuff, minutia, that's visible. Now, in a movie Civil War, you, of course, take mechanisms that are visible in other civil wars, like Yugoslavia, Russia, Ukraine. We've seen the images distantly removed, quite safely detached from Europe and the United States. And it's happening somewhere else. And then knowing what happened in the last 10 years, and then you juxtapose that on the United States. So in the movie Civil War, the president is in his third term, which is normally a president runs only two terms, but this president somehow has achieved a third term. And the world is not super advanced. It's not a cyberpunk world. It's the guns are normal, recognizable objects. All the decor is normal. The cars are normal. So the world can't be far off technologically and culturally. Frame of references, 2020s at most. So that establishes an upper boundary. And I don't see President Biden running a third term. So this movie, Trump is of course finished by now. Trump is not going to be reelected. He is going to die in prison. So we can be safe to say we got lucky, because we are not in the timeline when Trump is going to be reelected and going to be able to enforce a third term, because that's what, of course, what he would do. And that's what he would be supported by his voters to do. It is a movie about those impressions. And Garland has chosen a vessel of a war documentary, because that's the vessel we are most intimately, as spectators, most intimately aware of. You have to have a bunch of stepping stones, or what they call laying pipe, interesting term. You have to have a bunch of narrative vessels, tools that are both intimate to the viewer and make sense in the story, and then you are allowed to depict the absurdity of a world like that, because that's the point. You have to pick, like, show the absurdity, just as you can just showcase the absurdity. Go back a century in this. Imagine being a union organizer in the 1930s in Germany. So you're living in Germany, you're a leftist union organizer, and you would be transported back in time from the 1950s, so 20 years later, so it's 1950, and you're living in East Germany, and then you're transported back to Berlin, and you have to warn your fellow citizens in the 1930s. It would be impossible, because the stories you tell are so patently absurd. The characters in those stories are so patently not credible, are beyond plausible. Like, nah, you're being silly. The last 10 years have been quite the same, quite absurd. Trump, Republicans, Israel, genocide, Israel on Gazans. That Israel would do such a thing is just, wow. The hatred and the alienation in the Israeli government that is doing this is so far-reaching, stupid. You have been subject to a genocide yourself as an ethnicity, and then you conduct shamelessly the same process. You do it yourself, which is saying something Freudian, probably. Stare into the abyss too long, and the abyss stares into you. So that last 10 years have been eventful in my life, but in the world. COVID is it wouldn't even be a credible Neil Stephenson or Charles Stross set of assumptions. I think they both make a comment on that when they write stories, and it says, yeah, we write stories which are sort of absurd or over the top, but reality is often sillier. So bear that in mind. The first thing I said when the movie ended, credits, that funny, hilarious scene with the music and everything at the end, and I turned to Brian. I was with Brian, my documentary maker. He invited me to see the movie, and I very happy with him that he did that. And I turned to him and I said, this is going to happen. And that is horrible. If it doesn't happen, if the movie Civil War doesn't happen in one form or another in the next 20 or 10 years in America, specifically in America, I would be surprised if it doesn't happen or something like this doesn't happen, because it is the goose is so cooked right now and the people are so restless and alienated and confused. Because I think it's mostly confusion, and it's mostly engineered confusion. I would be surprised if it doesn't happen, something like this. So, the set pieces of the movie are a bunch of journalists. Well, actually, one journalist and her loyal driver. Kirsten Dunst, from the first time I saw her, I really appreciate what she's done. Movie-wise, and not talking Spider-Man. Interview the Vampire, which was young, very small, petite, and she was already, she blew me away. In Melancholia, she showed a lot of what depression is and why people come to a point of depression, and that depression sometimes is listening to your intuition. In Melancholia, she depicts someone who gets it and as a result becomes so depressed that he can't even walk anymore. And she does this in a way that is very recognizable, because I've been exactly where she is, where she was in a movie. When in a movie the character can't walk and has to be fed and has this completely sullen expression facially. And she bears witness. She walks around in a haze, looking around, and bears witness to the end of the world. And not just the end of the world, the complete extinction. Like there's nothing left in the movie, Melancholia, of the world. Nothing. I think she knows that. It's sort of almost like as if she was clairvoyant and saw the future, but not consciously because it was too much to behold. Kirsten Dunst also does this. What was the other movie I wanted to look at with her? Well, she's been in quite a few movies, but she does this in Civil War as well. Overwhelming, extinguished, complete loss of fashion, and the irreversible kind. Even if you would make her life very happy and everything would be paradise, she would still carry that weight around. I think this is the face of Kirsten Dunst that is able to depict that, the eyes. She can turn her eyes into infinity, the war gaze. And she has that. I think as an actor, you have an image, and she has cultivated that image. And it yanks out of her in a movie. On contrast, she's in the presence of her driver, a very interesting guy, a very interesting actor, really good energy about this guy. We'll see a lot of him. And he is like an adrenaline junkie that is so fucking wired up with passion that he keeps going until the very end. He carries it forward to the very end. Is the driver in the movie an asshole? Yeah. But it's more than that. You have to be an asshole to be a war reporter and see this and say, yeah, this is so cool. Food is flying next to you. And you say, this is so cool. And that's a juxtaposition between Kirsten Dunst and the actor, that is the driver. I don't know the actor's name, but never mind. And then there is another juxtaposition, sort of like a triangle, to a very young girl that wants to tag along while they're doing a war reporting. And the young girl is an admirer of the veteran Kirsten Dunst character. There's like a whole bunch of contrast between the two. And the young pup wants to tag along and learn, but also wants to be at the right place at the right time. And she fucking is. She is there every step of the way. She sees it all, registers it all. And the difference is Kirsten Dunst is uploading video and, digital camera pictures to the cloud, while the young pup is shooting in black and white on an old camera. Probably, because it's the only thing she has. But she's really into that medium. She carries that medium literally on her all the time. And the projects she makes is good. She knows when to shoot. She knows the theory and she knows the practice. But now she needs the inner software. And she makes that transition from being so fucking terrified of what's happening, so overwhelmingly terrified. But that allows her to be in the moment. And she says that, I've never lived more than the last few days. And she immerses herself in that. She doesn't stop. And her fellow characters in the movie fool her along. They say, yeah, this is what you do. Do you want this? Do you want to go into that hell? Do you want to go into the darkness, the heart of darkness? And she makes that choice consciously. And therefore she succeeds. Whereas Kirsten Dunst says, I'm fucking done with this. I'm really done with this. Why do I do this? She asked that question, why do I do this? Because in her soul, she is so numb that the juices, the passions, the excitement no longer affects her. Or affects her firstly. She can't handle it anymore. She's like, fuck this shit. You know, this is too much. And for what? And that's the trajectory of civilizations. True. That's the reflection. Now there's a fourth character, which is like the Tufiarhawat from Dune, an old veteran reporter who knows it all. He's seen it all, and he is right, constantly. He's right. And but he says, yeah, I may be right. What's the point if you don't put your life on the line sometimes? you may be right and say, ah, fuck this shit, I'm out of here. Then what? And I think he has a beautiful moment in that realization that he was right. Yeah. Those four characters, I fucking love them. I really, really like the four characters. Actually, the young girl, I have a pathological need for youth. That's why I'm a life extensionist. And that's, of course, about missing stuff. Because looking in retrospect, of course, transition. I should have transitioned much earlier. And I should have made something fun happening around me much earlier. But I wasn't able to. And that's about wanting to relive things, which might very well be possible in the next 20 or so years. I might get lucky in that way. And that's Kirsten Dunst, is the veteran, the old veteran. And she is contrasted with the young actress. And I think I want to be that girl so badly. She's so much that look of, I'm doing this. You walk into situations which you 10 years ago were really unthinkable. And then you walk into the situations with a smile on your face and says, yeah, I'm going to do this. I'm going to do this. I have pushed my boundaries myself to an almost absurd degree in the last 10, 15 years, which was unthinkable before then. If you would have told me what I've done in the last 15 years to my version in 2008-09, I would have laughed and said, nah, no. But yeah, I did it. And actually telling me in advance would have ruined it. So the four characters, good. Then there's a fifth character, of course, and that is the president, which you only see a few times. This president does something, what the other characters also do, the other people, is like an actor as an image. So take Brad Pitt, for instance. He conveys a certain set of impressions from movie to movie. That's the character, that's the actor character type. And typecasting, so to speak. That is a way to make money as an actor. You become a sort of consistent character. And there's a lot of actors that do that. What's this guy from Taken? Liam Neeson. He plays the same role over and again and makes a lot of money with it. Because there's an urgent need for tragic, heroic guys that make it, despite being old and worn. But they are experienced and they're very tough. And he conveys that from movie to movie. Kirsten Dunst also does that. And the president in... I saw him recently in the president of the movie Civil War. I saw him recently as the most amazingly deep, hilarious, tragic character in... what's that zombie movie? Zombie series on... I forgot. Zombie series with the fungus heads. And he was a character in that series, which aroused enormous anger in the viewers. Woke and blah and disgusting. And I just fucking couldn't stop crying for 2 days after seeing that character. Yeah, I was heartbroken for literally 2 days about seeing that process. Yeah. It's sort of an ambiguous happy after all. Of happily ever after. Happily ever after can be very tragic and very painful. But it was portrayed... so good. That actor is going to carry that loudmouth, fake libertarian bullshitter along in his career. That's going to be a character actor. And he is only shown depicted a few times in Civil War, but very effectively. And the president, in the movie Civil War, is in his third term. And he's shooting at protesters with live ammunition. He has his units, his soldiers shoot at protesters. And he is fake. Obviously, most politicians have to be a carefully manicured construct, but this guy is so fake. And he thinks, yeah, I've been doing it for quite a while. Sort of like the Gaddafi element. I've been doing this for like a whole bunch of years. I have no reason to believe that's going to end, this party. And this party ended for the guy. And the president in Civil War faces the consequences of being a third term US president that disbanded the FBI. Clichés. That places him on par with Donald Trump. Of course, Donald Trump is finished. Donald Trump is not going to be reelected. He's going to go to prison. He's going to like have the shock of his life when the first day he spends his night in prison, he's probably going to go insane. He's going to try to do everything to get out of prison. Crying, screaming, smearing the walls with shit, whatever. This is a pampered, Donald Trump is a pampered, useless piece of shit. And he's now being revealed to the world as such. And that's why it utterly bewilders me why such a total useless, narcissistic child could arouse those emotions in his electorate. Well, maybe I answered my own question. Yeah, we're stuck with Donald Trump for the foreseeable future, but he's going to end. And he is going to end in a way that everyone thinks, what was happening? We were suffering from collective mass derangement syndrome. But that's not the point. Somehow Donald Trump made it to presidency through a modicum of talent in a particular direction and a whole bunch of luck, or in his case. how does one become a president? How does one lose presidency like Al Gore? We've been in a much better world if Al Gore would have been president instead of W. When I turned to Brian, I was with Brian watching the movie Civil War, Brian and Hartog, he's my documentary maker, and I turned to him and I said, this is going to happen. And that was the first strong gut emotion. And it was twofold, of course. The movie was compelling, so I was in the suspension of disbelief and it was credible. But I also have the feeling that we are, especially America, but it's happening everywhere, that we collectively as a global society, global civilization, we are wired up. And I could say a bunch of things about that. I think it's ingrained in humanity to go through anticipated cycles of self-destruction, purging ourselves of all the useless eaters, so to speak. And we do that instinctively. However, with the technology we have right now, we can't do that anymore. So people would march off to Frischer, Fröhlicher Krieg, let's go and kick the other side. Like it's a soccer match. We go home with a bunch of bruises and scrapes, but we go home. Well, they didn't. Millions of soldiers in World War I died horribly. They came home disfigured. Like Arnold Schwarzenegger says, do not envy the Nazis because they came home as broken men, as losers, with shrapnel in their bodies, their minds and their bodies scarred for life. They would never amount to anything anymore except very angry, bitter people lost to history. And the old days when there were knights and soldiers and peasants, and you see that in... there was a movie about the English king that would go off to France, and then he discovered that his personal advisors lied to him in order to create, to cultivate a legend. People would march off with increasing enthusiasm, with great enthusiasm. Like, wow, we're off to war. We're going to honor, glory, etc. I think that desire is very strong in humans right now. They want to score. They want to men particularly, they want to be virile and heroic and glorious and like masculine. So you come back from war and you get all the chicks because you can't get any now right now. But you come home with a whole bunch of cut off ears and stolen jewelry. And in case of Russia, along a whole bunch of stolen refrigerators and toilets. And your wife is very happy, your girlfriend is very happy because you brought her a new iPad. War is about looting. And you see that in Civil War. There's a bunch of bandits. And you don't realize, hey, these are not soldiers. These are not militia. These are fucking bandits. And what that is. And they are never held to account. They never face any justice, meaningful justice. At best, they become another corpse in a corpse pile. That's war. It is a whole bunch of injustice leveraged on people that had no clue what they were getting themselves into, or people that didn't sign up to anything. You are one day working in a clothing store and there's a civil war and you say, I don't want to get into it. And a few days later, you find yourself in a shallow grave when someone's powdering over you to help your corpse disintegrate. Civil War is actually a really good warning for this. I think a whole bunch of people watch this movie while still having the atavistic urge, we are going to kick those goddamn liberals. And then they saw Civil War and they might be, oh fuck, that's not going to be as fun as I thought it would be. Yeah. I hope Civil War does something. Like I said, we got lucky in our timeline. The timeline I'm in right now, I'm in very, very many ways very lucky compared to what came before. My life before 2010, before 2005 was pure hell. And self-imposed because I didn't know any better. But now things are pretty good here. So in this timeline, I got lucky, but the world's also got lucky because got rid of Trump. Like I said, Trump is going to be in prison soon. We're going to literally see the day that Trump is going to stand there screaming at his lawyers. He's going to throw a fit and he's going to end up in prison. But Trump could have had a third term, like a visibly geriatric, haggard Trump, hoisted in his suit, obviously overweight, sick, delusional, deranged in his 80s or something, would have been a third term president, no doubt. He would have become a third, and a lot of people would have supported him. That's, yeah, FEMA camps, let's do it, barbed wire, and let's do nerve gas this time. And they would have literally eradicated a whole bunch of other people on the other side. That would have happened, yeah, 100% sure. And then some even worse sociopath would have inherited the presidency, and that one would have gone for three terms, maybe Trump Jr., I don't know. Maybe Ivanka, I have no idea. The Trump presidency is gone. There's not going to be a second term. I would be very surprised. Well, there's no lack of surprises in history, even in recent history. I would be very surprised if Trump amounts to anything anymore, but that doesn't allow us to be complacent, because this is happening. This is process of happening. There's one review of the movie, Civil War, I really appreciated, which said, this whole movie is about a whole bunch of war larvers. This is about a whole bunch of people that are like gearing up for the excitement for whatever perceived personal gain, and not collective gain, personal gain, looting. And they are excited because, yeah, we are now going to kick some ass and the other side deserves it. That is going to happen, I'm afraid. We're kind of out of the weather with regards to Trump, but there's going to be another sociopath like him. that's going to try to pull this off. And there's going to be a whole bunch of supporters that says, yeah, we need a lot less black people. We need a lot less Jews. We need a lot less socialists. We need a lot less transgenders. We need a lot less faggots. We need a lot less this. We need a lot less this. And women, we have to really kick ass and send women back into the kitchen and stuff like that. The desire is there. The market is there. The demographic is there. Supply and demand. There's a lot of demand for let's go and kick ass. In 2012, I stayed in America for a while. And I was in Mountain View. I was in Mountain View, Jesus, of all places. I met Orville Gray there. I met two friends or two people I knew that were living with Orville Gray. And Orville Gray, look up his Wikipedia page. And I casually walked into the Singularity University, and I attended Folsom Street Parade. That was the last time I saw Dan Messi alive, a guy that was super influential in my life, but relevant to this. I stayed at a bunch of people's places, and one guy, I would have no idea who he was, and I wouldn't know his name. I would have to really research who he was, but he was about as libertarian as you can get, the crazy gung-ho militant nutcase libertarian. He ran a blog, a libertarian Randian Ayn Rand sociopath LARP vlog, and he said with a straight face, America should start using its nukes. I think it's time to nuke, let's nuke Iran, let's nuke Tehran, completely obliterated. It's time that America goes kick some ass. This is straitjacket territory. We have a lot of those around, but we already have those slowly coming out of the woodwork. That was one of the most interesting experiences, someone saying that with a straight face in 2012. So this has been a long time coming, this crazy shit. Yeah, Civil War. Now, the cinematics are just very predictable. It's just like a whole bunch of boxes. That's the scenes. That's the succession of scenes. And he has his research team says, I need something of this. And he said, let's watch a bunch of war documentaries recent time. We need some absurdity. And that's box number six. That's scene number six. He throws in some concepts. At some point, they discard a whole bunch of darlings. They murder a whole bunch of babies. And then you end up with a succession of scenes and impressions of the world that makes sense. A road strewn with abandoned vehicles and personal belongings and probably a few corpses here and there, which would ordinarily be in a zombie movie a few years ago, but we don't do zombie movies anymore like that. Now we go straight for the... We don't do metaphors anymore, for zombie movies was a metaphor for this. And now we do the actual Civil War, we show it. And cities that are completely bombed, and in the distance you see buildings burning, and you see fighter jets through frost, and helicopters move in on the target. And, this is what we need, and we throw it in the bin. That's a bit of a criticism I have with Villeneuve. In this regard, I like Alex Garland, and I really like Ben Blomkamp. And Blomkamp does it really well in District 9. The granular detail of the technology and the stuff. The world building is just, oh my God. I'm so sad that there is not going to be a Neil Blomkamp alien version. But yeah, was not meant to be. My criticism with Denis Villeneuve is that he under depicts the future. And that is, I think that's a really glaring omission with him. He consciously does that. because he's like sort of like a pastel painter. He paints in very broad strokes and impressions. And although the movie June and June 2 may appear to be very densely packed with futuristic images, it's not. It's super clean canvas. Is that a good thing? Personally, it's a matter of taste. I don't like it. It's too empty. I would have loved a whole bunch more Neil Blomkamp in the movie June and June 2. I think I should do a review of either and both movies soon. But this is done very well in Civil War. Of course, it's within constraints in budget, CGI, etc. But it's so hard hitting those necessary scenes, those crucial world-building laying vibe scenes that culminate to the end. I actually visited Washington, D.C. in 2011. I was there for like a while. I walked, my feet paddled places that are shown in the movie Civil War. I made a few stupid photos. I was so confused back then, still am. I will be confused for the foreseeable future for a long time. But I just, this is the White House. This is defense. And this is that little square in front of the White House. Oh my God, this is actually a real place. It's not Disneyland. No, it's real. It's a bit underwhelming when you're there. You're aware that you're in an empire. All throughout Washington, D.C., the signs of an empire are there. You can literally march the armies back and forth, do military parades there. It's an empire. The people are under no illusions that they're part of the biggest military economic power the world has ever seen. They're painfully aware of that in Washington, D.C. There's a lot of money sloshing around there to a ridiculous degree. People are making left and right millions, almost with the casual casual arrogance you can imagine. But I was there, and I saw those scenes again. And I was also in San Francisco a year later, and I walked Fisherman's Wharf, and then I saw those same realistic spots that I was physically walking around in a movie Godzilla, which is absurd. Civil War is a good movie. Highly recommended. Good acting, good storyline building. The most cruel thing they could do to the director is declare, yeah, we found the director and we found the budget. We're going to make a TV series out of it. That would be so incredibly dumb. But that is what happens right now. Yeah, like 2 years, we have the Civil War TV series. And that is the most horrible statement you can make on the matter. This has to be a definitive statement, but it's going to be copied. There we're going to be a next Civil War movie. From a new perspective, of course. Slightly different elements. But yeah, I wouldn't be surprised that 2 years, you would have a Civil War TV series on Netflix. Because it's so exciting. And that's the thing that the main characters also depict. Kirsten Dunst is done with it. The character portrayed by Kirsten Dunst is like, ugh. I'm fucking done with this shit. But the two young pups, they really dig it. Yeah. Make the bullet fly. Because this is the first time I've ever lived. I'd never lived as strongly as I left in the last 5 days. That's what she says, the young reporter. We don't learn. As a species. Yeah. This is going to happen. That is my conclusion. And I stay with that conclusion. This is going to happen in one form or another. And then we forget and we were going to do it again 50 years later until we, as a human being, stop being human beings and become something better. But even then, I don't know.